the last lesson, the part lesson of the Flamingo book, that is the last lesson, which is written by the French novelist Alphonse Daudet. He was born in 1840 to 1897. Now, this story is held in 1870 to 1871 in the Franco-Prussian War. Prussia in the older days now consists of modern days countries like Germany, Poland and Austria. It was led by Baron Bismarck. Now Prussia had conquered two regions of France, that is Alsace and Lorraine. These two regions were captured by Prussia, and here now the story starts. This story merely comes about a small boy named Franz, and this story is based on his thinking and the life in the city of Alsace. I started for school very late that morning and was in great dread of a scolding, especially because M. Hamel said that he would question us on participles, and I did not know the first word about them. For a moment, I thought of running away and spending the day out of doors. It was so warm, so bright, the birds were chirping at the edge of the woods, and in the open field back of the sawmill, the Prussian soldiers were drilling. It was all much more tempting than the rural participles, but I had the strength to resist and hurry to the school. In the first paragraph, we see the thinking of Franz. Now, his teacher was Mr. M. Hamel, whom he was very afraid of. Now, it was a sunny day and the weather was very tempting. He did not want to go to school anyway because he would be questioned on the rule of participles and he did not know a single thing. There was a sawmill in the back of which Russian soldiers were drilling, which was more tempting than go to school. When I passed the town hall, there was a crowd in front of bulletin board. For the last 2 years, all our bad news had come from there. The lost battles, the draft, the orders of commanding officer. And I thought to myself, without stopping, what can be the matter now? Then as I hurried by as fast as I could, the blacksmith watcher, who was there with his apprentice, reading the bulletin, called after me, "Don't go so fast, Bob, you will get to your school in plenty of time." I thought he was making fun of me and read M. Hamel's Little Garden out of breath. Now, as we know, the story has been taken about in the Franco-Prussian War, and there was a crowd in the town hall about reading the today's bulletin. There was always bad news coming because France was constantly losing their wars, and there was orders from the commanding officer. So when he was passing the town hall, he was wondering what is the next bad news coming now. But when he was hurried, he had no time to watch the bulletin. But now the blacksmith watcher said, "Slow down." He thought he was making fun of him. But now we will see what happens there. He hurried fast and reached Mr. K.M. Hamel's Little Garden. Now the third paragraph. Usually when school began, there was a great bustle which could be heard in the street, the opening and closing of desks. Lesson repeated in unison, very loud, with our hands over our ears to understand better, and the teacher's great ruler rapping on the table. But now it was all so still. I had counted on the commotion to get to my desk without being seen. But of course that day everything had to be as quiet as Sunday morning. Through the window, I saw my classmates already in their places and M. Hamel walking up and down with his terrific iron ruler under his arm. I had to open the door and go in before everybody. You can imagine how I blushed and frightened I was. Now in the third paragraph, he describes the regular bustle of the school. Now in school, we heard every noises, every bustle, but today there was a still silence. He did not know why. From the windows, he saw his classmates were all seated and M. Hamel in the room. Like in every school, his teacher had a ruler under his arm. He thought he would escape to the bustle without being caught by the teacher. But today, as everyone was so still like a Sunday morning, he blushed when he entered the room in front of everybody and frightened. because he was already late. Now from the fourth paragraph. But nothing happened. Ian Hamel saw me and said very kindly, "Go to your place quickly, little friends, for we are beginning without you." I jumped over the bench and sat down at my desk. Not till then, when I got a little over my fright, did I see that our teacher had on his beautiful green coat, his frilled shirt, and little black silk cap, all embroidered, that he never wore except inspection and prize days. Besides, the whole school seemed so strange and solemn. But the thing that surprised me most was to see on the back benches that were already always empty, the village people sitting quietly like ourselves. Old Hauser has a thin cornered hat, the former mayor, the former postmaster, and several others besides. Everybody looked sad, and Hauser had got an old primer thumb at the edges and held it open on his knees and with his great spectacles lying on the faces. Now, he was thinking he would get scolded or beaten by the M. Hamel like normal days. For today, it seemed strange. M. Hamel talked to him kindly and said, "Go to the street, friends." He was very astonished. What happened? And now, he today saw that M. Hamel wore his green coat, his all-embroidery shirt, silk tie, embroidery cap. He always wore on some good occasions. But today was just a normal day. He did not know why. And there was empty seats, many empty seats in the back. But today it was all filled by villagers. Now we see that the back benches were filled by old Hauser. The former postmaster. Former postmaster, the former mayor. So we can see that many top class people were there to seek knowledge from Mr. M. Hamel. He did not know how. Why? M. Now, Hauser wore a tricolored hat in his head and hold an old primer. An old primer is an old book about French language. He also wore great spectacles lying on the pages, and we think your old Hauser is like grasping everything in a single day. While now the fifth paragraph. While I was wondering about it all, M. Hamel mounted his chair and in the same grave and gentle tone which he had used to me, said, "My children, this is the last lesson I shall give you. The order has come from Berlin to teach only German in the schools of Alsace and Lorraine. The new master comes tomorrow. This is your last lesson. I want you to very attentively." With a thunderclap, these words were to me. Oh, the wretches! That was what they had put up at the town hall. My last French lesson. Why, I hardly knew how to write. I should never learn anymore. I must stop there then. Oh, how sorry I was for not learning my lessons, for seeking birds' eggs or going sliding on the sand. My books, that was, seemed such a nuisance a while ago, so heavy to carry. My grammar and my history of the saints were all old friends now, was that I could not give up. And Mr. M. Hamel, the idea that he was going away, that I should never see him again, made me forget all about his ruler and how cranky he was. Now, while he was wondering about the unexpected day, what was happening, now Mr. M. Hamel said with a brave tone, "Now, students, this is my last lesson, and I want all to be very attentive. And from tomorrow, your new German teachers have come." Now, I have to debate in the topic. Now, we are all in this country, we are made from many languages, like Hindi, Odia, Tamil, Telugu. But we become a community. A community is distinguished by its language. Now when a new country, that is Prussia, covered up against Lorraine and Alsace of the French, they want to destroy their culture. When their culture and their language is destroyed, automatically the area comes under their rule. When we don't have a culture, something to hold fast, there is no unity among us. So we should always hold fast to our language. Now the Prussian people are very clever. They wanted to destroy the language and their culture from the bottom line, from the students, so that the young children of Alsace and Lorraine would not know French. And they decided to take all the teachers and the French teachers to get away from the city, and new German language will be taught to them. So from the childhood, they will be Prussians, not French people. Now, France knew what was written on the town hall. Why town hall was so crowded today? Now, seeing this idea, he was very sad. The history, the French language, which always seemed nuisance, now seemed like old friends. M. Hamel was always very rude to him, very cranky, and beaten him with his iron ruler, now seemed like old friends that he would not like to part upon. Poor man, it was in honor of his last lesson that he had put on his fine Sunday clothes, and now I understood why the old men of the village were sitting there in the back of the room. It was very because they were sorry too that they had not gone to school more. It was their way of thanking our master for his 40 years of faithful service and showing off their respect for the country that was theirs no more. While I was thinking of all this, I heard my name called. It was my turn to recite. What would I not have given to be very loud and clear and without one mistake? But I got mixed up on the first words and stood there, holding on to my desk, my heart beating, not daring to look up. I heard M. Hamel to say to me, "I won't scold you, live in France, you must feel bad enough. See how it is. Every day we have said to ourselves, bah, I have plenty of time. I will learn it tomorrow. And now you see where we have come out. Ha, that's a great trouble with Alsace. It puts off learning till tomorrow. Now those fellows out there have the right to say to you, how is it? You pretend to be Frenchmen, and yet you can neither speak or write your own language. But you are not the host, poor little France. We all have a great deal to reapproach ourselves with." Now, as we know, France did not learn a single word about the participles. When he was called upon to recite participles, he could not speak a single word, and he was mixed up in the first sentences only. Now he was thinking of getting scolding or beating from Mr. M. Hamel. But M. Hamel said he was not going to then do any of these things. Now he said France was not to blame enough. Now as I told earlier, in a community we can see that what makes us strong in a community is our language, our culture. Now M. Hamel criticizes the people of Alsace because now as the Prussian army have come to their country, they were questioned, "You don't know to speak or neither write your own language. How you pretend to be Frenchmen? Now they will taught you German and you will forever be the slaves of Prussian army." Now he said that not only France to be blamed upon, he said a people of Alsace are to be blamed upon for this mistake, because they did not ever care for education. Education was their last. Your parents were not anxious enough to have you learn. They preferred to put you to work on a farm or at the mills, so as to have a little more money. And I have sent you to water my flowers instead of learning your lessons. And when I wanted to go fishing, did I not give you a holiday? Then from one thing to another, M. Hamel went on talking to French language, saying that it was the most beautiful language in the world, the clearest, the most logical, that we must guard it among us and never forget it, because when people are enslaved, as long as they hold fast to their language, it is as if they have the key to their prison. Then he opened a grammar and read us our nation. I was amazed to see how well I understood it. All he said seemed too easy, so easy. I think too that I had never listened so carefully, and that he had never explained everything with so much patience. It seemed almost as if the poor man wanted to give us all he knew before going away and to put it onto our hands. Now, he said, our people of Alsace went education. They never gave importance to education. Their parents were to be blamed upon. They sent their students to be farmers to get a little money. And now he also blamed himself. He said he often sent his students to water his flowers, or he simply gave him a holiday when he felt like going to fishing or doing some extracurricular work of his own. Now he started his lesson on participles. Now M. Hamel taught in so much patience. Franz understood everything. He was amazed how he understood everything. He thought that it was because he never heard the lessons with so much patience, and Mr. M. Hamel neither taught him in this way as he is teaching today. As if he was going to give every lesson he knew, everything he knew, to the students and the villagers. After we had the grammar, we had a lesson on writing. That day, M. Hamel had new copies for us, written in a beautiful handwritten France, Alsace, France, Alsace. They looked like little flags floating everywhere in the schoolroom, hung from the rod at the top of our desk. We ought to have seen how everyone set to work, how quiet it was. The only sound was the scratching of the pens over the paper. Once some beetles flew in, but nobody paid any attention to them, not even the little ones, who walked right on dressing their fish hoods, as if it was French too. On the roof, the pigeons cooed very low, and I thought to myself, will they make them sing in German, even the pigeons? Whenever I looked up from my writing, I saw M. Hamel sitting motionless in his chair and gazing first at that one thing and then at another, as if he wanted to fix in his mind just how everything looked in that little schoolroom. Fancy, for 40 years he had been there, in the same place, with his garden outside the window and his class in front of him. Just like that, only the desk and benches had been worn smooth. The walnut trees in the garden were taller, and the hope vine that he had planted himself twined about the windows to the roof. How it must have been broken his heart to leave it all, poor man, to hear his sister moving about the room above, packing their trunks, for they must leave the country the next day. Now, after the grammar lessons, they had a teaching on writing. Now, Mr. M. Hamel had new copies for everyone, where he had written France, Alsace, France, Alsace. Now, Franz thought it was as if it looked like a French flag that was stood upon the shaft. The desks all looked like a shaft, and the copies all looked like French flags. Now, everyone sat upon the writing. Beetles flew in, but nobody paid attention to them, not even the small ones. The fish hooks of M. Hamel were presented as if they were like French flags. Now, after the lessons, he saw that Mr. M. Hamel was looking everywhere in the room. He was motionless and very sad. He looked at the walnut trees, he looked at the hope vine that he planted, and the desk and the students in front of him, as if he was there to capture all the things in his mind. He has been giving teaching for 40 years. The only thing that has changed from the 40 years to now, that is the desk and the benches are worn out, and everything has been the same. Fancy, isn't it? He was now hearing Mr. M. Hamel's sister packing all the things because they had to leave the next day. Now, as we knew, the people of Prussia as imposing German language, they also get a clever idea of sending all the teachers and the activists from that area, because they will not get any reward. As MML is a learned man, he can start a revolution. So here, the French Prussian army had ordered the teachers to leave so that German teachers will come the next day. Now the little France was wondering whether peasants that were doing food in the classrooms, whether they were going to teach German by the Prussian army. But he had the courage to hear every lesson to the very last. After the writing, we had a lesson on history, and then the babies chanted their ba, be, bi, bo, bu. Down there, at the back of the room, Oldhauser had put on his spectacles and, holding his primer in both hands, spelled the voice, trembled with emotion, and it was so funny to hear him that we all wanted to laugh and cry. Ah, how well I remember it, the last lesson. All at once, the church clock struck 12, then the Angelus. At the same moment, the trumpets of the Prussian army returning from drill sounded under our windows. MML stood up very pale in his chair. I never saw him look so tall. Now, MML sat right there. He had the courage to hear every lesson. We know he was emotional because it was his last day, but he summed up all his courage to be there. Now the small children were getting lessons of their ba, be, bi, bo, bu, which is the starting of the French lessons. They saw the old primer, the old Hauser that has brought his primer, that a book, old book on French, was chanting the French language. He was emotional and was emotional. Everyone who heard laughed, were wanting to laugh and cry at the same time. What a moment it was. Franz said that he would not forget the day, but the rest of his life, because it was a most beautiful day and his last lesson. He was very emotional and very happy too. All at once, now he saw the clock struck 12, the Prussian army who were drilling in the back of the sawmill were coming to the home. Now the trumpets were marching. Now Mr. MML stood up on his chair. He was as if very frightened, so he looked very tall and pale. My friends, said he, I, but something choked him. He could not go on. Then he turned to the blackboard, took a piece of chalk, and hearing on with all his might, he wrote as large as he could, Vive la France. Then he stopped and leaned his head against the wall, and without a word, he made a gesture to us with his hand. School is dismissed. You may go. Now, as we know, he was very emotional. The clock struck 12, the Prussian army were retiring. As he was ordered to leave the city of Alsace, he was frightened, as if the army would do something to him. He stood up from the chair, submitting with all his energy to say something. But as he was very emotional, he could not say anything. He simply put up a chalk and wrote, Vive la France, which means in English, long live France. After the lesson, it was the last lesson and the last day, he gestured with his hands, because he could not speak a single word, and gestured them, the school is dismissed and you may go. So now, this is the end of the story. The story, the first chapter, the last lesson, which was written by Alfonso Daudet. Now, what I get, the summary of the story, that here, the writer wrote this story to say the students, to say the people about the importance of language, the culture, of a reason. If you hold fast to our language, our culture, we always have a key to our prison. Whenever a country is conquered or is dominated, whenever a community is dominated, as long as we hold to our language, our community, our culture, we always have the key to our freedom. Now, the important questions of this chapter are the summary. As I told you, it is about holding fast to our language, our culture, and importance of our culture and language in this modern world. And now, you will all practice the questions either from All-in-One book or NCERT book. All-in-One book or NCERT book, which is good for you. And you should all practice the small key points. You should understand the key points like Vive la France and the people that came for the last lesson, like the old hussar, the former postman, the former mayor. Why they had come? They had come to pay respect to Mr. N. Hamel, who had given 40 years of service to the school, and how he was very emotional, and the thinking of France, especially the thinking of France, what was his thinking, and how he was feeling on the last lesson. With this, I'd like to say thank you.